Yes, Vimala, can you start now? Good morning. On behalf of Andhra Pradesh Forest Department, I cordially welcome the speakers and viewers and Divya Education Officer of Indira Gandhi Zoological Park. Currently, we are undergoing week 14, day 7 as a part of conservation. The people to as the celebration of 5 years of Indian independence. Today, we are going to have a webinar on behavior on dolls, veterinary care on Asiatic wild dogs, and behavior breeding followed by. From Wildlife Institute of India. She started to study the behavior of dolls during wildlife science for masters at Wildlife Institute of India. She also studied on radio collared dispersing tigers in the human dominated landscape in eastern Vidarbha. Currently, she is working on ecology of dolls. She will speak us today on behavior of dolls, and she will discuss about the unique species which in dire need for attention and conservation efforts. Over to you, Pallavi, to please begin your talk.
Shall I start?
Yes, yes, Pallavi, you can start.
Okay, I'll just share my screen now.
Okay.
Please let me know if you can see it.
Yes, okay.
Is it visible?
No, Pallavi, it is not visible.
How about now?
Okay.
Okay, shall I start?
Yes, you can start.
Okay. So good morning, everyone. And I would like to thank the IGZP for giving me this opportunity to share my work with all of you. There have been fantastic talks throughout the week on dolls. And what I'd like to do is share my personal journey studying these enigmatic creatures over the last 4 to 5 years. So the story started way back in 2014 when I was a master's student at the Wildlife Institute of India, and we had to choose a topic to do a short dissertation project of about 6 months. Since I'd been extremely intrigued by social carnivores, I headed straight to the beautiful grasslands around Pune where I'd grown up, looking for the wolf. However, after a recce survey of about 15 days, all I found were few signs, and I quickly learned that it was not going to be easy to do a short project on the ghosts of the grassland. So then I was faced with a daunting task of rethinking my plans, and I listed down what were the things that interested me. This is what my list looked like. Around the same time, I was reading a fascinating book by Dr. John Singh, in which he talks about his field experiences in the Western Ghats. Finally, on our own conservation tour to Periyar, it struck me that the animal that checked all these boxes was indeed the dhole. It was almost like the universe was prodding me towards this species. As I started reading more and more about dholes, I was puzzled by the villainous portrayal of the species in the past. British naturalist Fytham Adams even mentioned in his journal, except for his handsome appearance, the wild dog has not a single redeeming feature, and no effort, fair or foul, should be spared to destroy these pests of the jungle. Rudyard Kipling, among others, called the dhole the Red Devils in the Second Jungle Book, depicted here by the brilliant Japanese artist Sergei Artishenko. There was also a bounty declared of 25 rupees, a big deal those days, to encourage dhole hunting, as they were believed to chase away big game, which the British colonial hunters would have liked to hunt themselves. As I dug deeper, I found that there were very few studies conducted on dholes, 3 to be precise. And that was the pioneering work done by Doctors A.J.T. John Singh, Venkatraman, and Bhaskaracharya. There were other studies involving dholes, but those were more generic and had the big cats as the protagonists. I thought such limitations in our understanding of the species would be a major reason why there were any why there was a lack of any conservation initiatives for this endangered mammal until the recent past. To really appreciate the importance of the species, we need to understand what makes it unique. Dholes are monotypic. It means that they are the only species anywhere on the planet that belong to the genus Kuon. This sets them apart from other true dogs belonging to the genus Canis, like the wolves, jackals, or coyotes. They're characterized by their peculiar dentition, evolved for tearing flesh, and have an extra pair of teeth to support large litter sizes. We now know that there are fewer dholes in the wild than tigers and elephants. Yet until very recently, we'd never heard of any conservation initiatives for the dhole. And lastly, as we've seen over the last week, captive population of dholes in India are very limited, and restocking them in the wild wouldn't be an easy task if it came to it. Dholes have many other cool tricks up their sleeves, one of them being that they whistle to communicate amongst each other. Not howl, not bark, but whistle. And this video, I hope it doesn't lag. It'll show you what exactly it sounds like. So that was the whole whistle with which they communicate with each other. They're also one of the most efficient hunters of the Indian forests. And as you may see in this clip, they've evolved to eviscerate their prey even before it's completely dead. Now, it may seem a little gory, but trust me, it's pretty mind-boggling to observe super predators in action. You can see the cheetah's not even completely dead, and they've already eaten half of it. So they can take down prey 10 times their size and even spook the largest land-dwelling mammal, which is the elephant. But hold on. These mean-looking hunting machines are also known for their highly social bonds and cooperative breeding, as you can see in this video clip, wherein the entire pack raises the pups sired by the dominant or the alpha pair. Dholes are found in most parts of South and Southeast Asia. But in India, they're primarily found in three regions, that is the Western Ghats, the Central Indian landscape, and the Northeast. The Terai landscape also had dholes until the British Raj, but were locally extinct due to hunting. This picture on your right is a picture, a camera trap image of the Terai dholes taken by F.W. Champion, who was a British conservationist photographer who pioneered camera trap photography anywhere in the world. My work is based in the Central Indian landscape, more specifically the Vidarbha landscape, which is a mosaic of agricultural fields and protected areas, like the Tadoba Andhari Tiger Reserve, the Umret Karandra Wildlife Sanctuary, the Navegaon Nazira Tiger Reserve, the Pench Tiger Reserve, the Bor Tiger Reserve, and Tipeshwar Wildlife Sanctuary. On the right, you see a map of Tadoba, which was where I conducted most of my studies. And you may notice that it's mostly a dry deciduous forest. And when I say dry deciduous forest, the image that comes to your mind would be that of yellow hues like this one. But trust me, Tadoba completely transforms in the monsoon, and you have hues of green and blue. And it's a stunning landscape to work in. So here I was in Tadoba, and as you can imagine, I was bombarded with tiger tales and tiger sightings inside the park, outside the park in fields, the occasional leopard sighting, and also more drama, which of course included tigers. So it would have been quite easy to be carried away by all this, if not for a team of senior researchers who helped me take baby steps into this wild world. This is a picture of our team. This is Madhura. She was my senior who worked on tigers. This is Anil, who was a botanist, and this is Nilanjan, whose work mainly focused on camera trapping. Yes, that is the Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra, Mr. Uddhav Thackeray, but trust me, this was the only decent picture I had of our entire team together. Along with this team of researchers, I also had the finest field assistants one could ever dream of, and my work is as much as theirs as it is mine. Special mention to Mr. Ashok Kedar, who was the forest guard who taught me how to walk these tiger forests, and he was more interested in wild dogs than tigers. So with a village by my side, I started observing dholes in their natural habitat. And soon, I started recording some cool behaviors like this one, where I did not know what exactly was happening. So is this play, is this fight, or is it a play fight? This led me to develop what is known as an ethogram, which is basically an inventory of behaviors. Cataloging behaviors helped me in studying the behavioral ecology of dholes further. The categories were like rest, locomotion, social behavior, feeding, scent marking, and other miscellaneous behaviors. With around 10 hours of video recording observational data, we found they spend most of their times resting or moving around marking territories. We also found some interesting behaviors, which were new to science, like the hind bounce and hind scrub. Both these behaviors are related to scent marking, and I shall show you what they look like in a minute. Another cool behavior was the handstand urination, which had some anecdotal references in the past, but the function was unclear. Upon studying this, we found that this was indeed a form of mate guarding, where the dholes balance on their front paws and mark the exact spot as their partner or their mate. This is a short clip where you can see all the behaviors. So that's the hind bounce followed by the scrub. The dhole on the right will show the hind scrub behavior. All these behaviors were always with other scent marking behaviors, and that's how we knew that this was related to scent marking and not some infection or anything else. You can see this dhole is marking its scent by body rubbing and by bouncing its hind on the stack of grass. This is a video of the handstand urination. You can see it mostly happens in pairs. There, the dhole did a handstand. There's another video which is slightly more clear. This is the male, dominant male, who marks a particular place. Then you'll see the female go and mark the exact same point by doing a handstand urination event. And then this would be again followed by the male masking her scent. This behavior reiterates to their own pack and to the other packs that they are a bonded, they are partners and they are the dominant pair. We published these results in the Journal of Mammalogy, and hence I finished my master's degree. For the next 2 years, I shifted my focus from dholes to tigers, and I followed dispersing tigers in the human-dominated landscapes of Vidarbha. But in 2017, I was drawn back to Tarova and dholes, and I registered for my PhD and took off where I had left. It had always been my dream to radio-collar dholes since my master's project, and I finally had the opportunity to do so. Capturing dholes was, however, a completely different ballgame than tigers, which I had learned in the past 2 years. This was because they're always on the move. They're always together, they're social animals, and we had to follow them to dart, as cages, lures, or foot traps were either logistically not possible or did not work. Here's a short clip of what darting a dhole looks like. You can see that is Dr. Nigam, whose reaction time, expertise, and accuracy is unmatched. And you can see how he manages to dart it in a split second, just while the dhole was about to urinate. So with a great team of experts, these are my mentors and supervisors on the left. And on the right, we have Dr. Khobragade and Mr. Ajay Marathe of the Maharashtra Forest Department. We ended up collaring 5 dholes across age and sex classes from 4 packs. And we used Vectronics GPS collars with activity sensors and located them by foot by VHF tracking on a daily basis. Our interfix intervals were 1 hour and we had about 8,000 locations. So for the first time ever for this species, we got an idea of the movement patterns in the natural habitat of dholes. We found that on average, dholes displaced more during the day than during the night, as they are diurnal creatures. We found that the average velocity of with which they walked was about 260 meters per hour. They always stop and move ahead. They're not in a hurry usually. The average displacement was more during the day, as I said before, and the displacement was less during the summer season due to intensive use of water holes. We also found the home ranges of these dholes using high resolution data to give us robust estimates. And in the middle, you can see there were 2 dholes from the same pack and their home range was slightly different. So that was something interesting. We also had a dhole which had a denning season while it was collared, and we saw how the home range has shrunk during this period and went back to being the original home range as the pups grew up. Interestingly, we also had radio collared tigers in the same area, and we were fascinated to find out how these two animals shared space. So these are 2 packs. The pink and the green are 2 different dhole packs, and the black is a tigress in the area. And you can see that there is some sort of overlap of the home ranges of the pack and the tiger. But if you look at the core areas, there was hardly any overlap. So they do overlap in general in terms of space, but the core areas are inviolate of each other's presence. So from a year of data that we collected, we found what sort of movement pattern the dhole shows in Taroba. And you can see that just before denning, there is a peak in activity, which drops during denning time and slowly gradually starts increasing up until May, where there's a second dip in the activity. That's because they are mostly limited to water holes during this peak summer, where the temperatures can soar up to 48 degrees Celsius. So to summarize this part, the average home range of dholes we found was about 59 square kilometers with a core area of about 8 square kilometers. The denning home range was 40 square kilometers, and they had unique den sites. There was not just one den site throughout the denning season. They also had multiple core areas during this time. And tigers and dholes did not overlap in their core areas. Along with this, we also had regular camera trapping, long-term camera trapping in Taroba, where we found that there was some sort of temporal overlap between tigers and dholes, and leopards and dholes. But you can see that the peaks were different. So the dhole activity peaked during the day, whereas the tigers and leopards were more nocturnal. The tigers were more active during dusk, while the leopards were more nocturnal. Since we had activity sensors in our collars, we found that the dholes, on the x-axis you have time of the day, and on the y-axis you have multiple days. So this is data over the days, and you can see something interesting. So these blue marks are where the activity is highest, and the yellow or the white are where it's lowest. And you can see during the denning time, the dholes had less displacement, but they were active throughout the day. So they were tending to their pups or taking care of each other, and were active throughout the day during this period. Lastly, we wanted to know how dholes compete with tigers in terms of their diet. And we found something very interesting. In 2016, when we studied scats using the conventional scat analysis method, we found that both tigers and dholes preferred chital in Taroba. So we considered that there was a substantial dietary overlap of these two species. However, with better tools like radiotelemetry and molecular tools, now we found that there's a fine-scale partitioning of resources where the dholes are harvesting the younger ones of cheetal, whereas the tigers are harvesting the adults. So there's a fine-scale segregation in terms of age classes. We're also doing some inter and intra-pack interaction studies. However, it's still an ongoing study, so you're going to have to wait for the results of this one. We have a team of people who are working on different aspects of dhole ecology. My colleague Srishti Modi is working on the genetics of dholes, and we've developed a panel of microsatellites and sex-specific markers for Asiatic wild dogs. Another colleague of mine, Aishwarya Bhandari, has recently published our work from Nagzira, where we show how the pack size variation in dholes would be governed by the densities of the apex predators like tigers. So in Tadoba, you would have smaller pack sizes due to high tiger densities, whereas in Nagzira, you would have larger pack sizes due to low tiger densities. I urge you to watch this video carefully. I assure you it's worth it. And this is basically what the paper talks about tiger densities and dhole densities. So that was the dholes being caught off guard by a tiger. However, tigers are not the real threats to dholes. It's us. This is, in pink, you can see the historic range of dholes. They ranged from India to the far Russia, up north to Russia, Russian Far East. And now they survive on only 20% of their previous global range. It's mainly because of habitat loss and fragmentation. There's a lot of threat of developmental projects like mining and linear infrastructure coming up in dhole habitats. And lastly, one of the major threats being disease. You can see in this picture, this is a free-ranging dog which is being chased away by dholes in a waterhole. This is from Tadoba. And disease like canine distemper or rabies or any other fatal diseases are one of the major threats to dholes. However, the future is not very bleak because there's suddenly a wave of dhole research happening in India especially, and other places like Thailand and Bhutan and Nepal and even Indonesia. The Forest Department is planning to reintroduce dholes in the Terai landscape, whereas a team from Wildlife Institute has radio-collared dholes in Kanha. There's also a group led by Dr. Arjun Srivastava from Bangalore who are working on estimating dhole population and conservation of dholes for the last few years. Along with getting to know about the ecology of dholes, we are also finally noticing new places where dholes occur, like this recent record of dhole from the Western Himalayas. For me personally, I feel I've learned a great deal from dholes, right from standing my ground in times of trouble to qualities like leadership, having patience, and the value of strong social bonds and strength. I've also learned the importance of studying natural history and giving importance to natural history when we are studying our species. And as a professor, John Anderson from the University of Atlanta, has put so well, that the most theoretical breakthroughs are preceded by deep observational work that seems to have fallen out of vogue in the past half century. I'd like to end with this natural history snippet. This is the actogram which I showed you before. One day we got a mortality signal, which means that we realized that our dhole seems to not move and was stationary at one particular place. So we hurried to the place to see what exactly had happened, only to find out this hole, which was indeed a den. And you can see in this video, the collared hole is a male. So we found that even fathers take care of their pups. As he comes out from this den, you can see a small pup emerging with it. That's the pup. And since it is Father's Day today, I thought this would be a great way of ending this talk. So thank you, and I'm open to any questions which you would have. My principal investigators are Dr. Bilal Habib and Dr. Parag Nigam from the Wildlife Institute of India. And all the photos, the copyrights are to the original photographers, and most of the videos are my own. Thank you.
Audible now? Hello?
Yes, Devi.
Is it audible?
It is.
Yes, okay. Thank you, Pallavi, for the informative talk. We will take up the question and answers of this session towards the end of the webinar. Now we will move up on to the second part of today's session. So now I would like to welcome Dr. Purushottam. Dr. Purushottam is a veterinarian graduated from NTR College of Veterinary Sciences, Gannavaram. And currently is working in Indira Gandhi Zoological Park for more than 1 year. I request Dr. Purushottam to please present your talk. Over to you, Purushottam. Purushottam, are you there? Purushottam?
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, please begin your talk, Purushottam.
Yeah. Thanks for the invitation, Divya. Yeah, let me share my screen now. Is it visible now?
Purushottam, it's hard to understand. No. Yes, no.
I think now I can start my session. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks. So, as part of Azadi Amrit Mahotsav, 1 week long celebration, today we are going to discuss about the veterinary care and how it played a role in successful breeding of the dolls at Indira Gandhi Zoological Park. So, let me introduce that our zoo now currently has 4 established packs from 3 different lineages, and which are housed in 3 different enclosures. And we are having 39 wild dogs, of which 29 are male, and 10 are female. So you can see that we have three enclosures, which was very natural. And the first one, we named it as A, and the second, it's B, and the third one is our conservation breeding center. And quickly moving on to the diet, which plays a major role in the health of the animals. Candid diets typically contain 20 to 28% of protein and 5 to 18% of fat and 2 to 4% of crude fiber on the trimeter basis. And if we are providing the meat which is lean and well trimmed, then we may supplement vitamin A and vitamin E, which is very much essential for them. And if the bones are not supplemented, then we have to supplement the calcium on trimeter basis. That is 1% calcium, which will be equivalent to around 7 grams of calcium per kg of the meat. So at our zoo park, we are feeding the animals twice a day. And at morning, we give 250 grams of chicken per animal. And in the evening, around 4 p.m., we give around 1 to 1.5 kg beef per animal. And that too depend on the individual. And Monday being the fasting day, but we provide chicken for both the young and senile animals. And these feed, all the feed is supplemented with the calcium, multivitamins and minerals on a regular basis. And coming to care during the breeding season, before entering that, I think we should have a basic information about the reproduction behavior of these animals. So Dholes exhibit typical canid reproductive patterns, which include frequent urine marking and vocalizing by both the sexes, and olfactory inspection of the marked spots and partner's genitalia in the male, approaching the female and licking the female genitals, and copulatory type and back-to-back copulatory washes. And the breeding season that we generally see is September to November, and the gestation long for 50 to 70 days, which varies. But on an average, it will be around 62 to 63 days. And size of the litter generally varies, and it is 3 to 9. And we have seen almost 9 to 10 pups in a litter. And weaning of the pups, it takes at around 60 to 70 days. And age of sexual maturity of the animal, it reaches around 11 months of age. And diet during breeding season, which plays a very important role in the healthy development of the fetus as well as the health of the dam. So in the first two-thirds of gestation, that is up to 46 days of the 46 days, we generally increase up to 10 to 20% of the feed. And in the last trimester, that is up to the 47th day, that is after completion of the two-thirds of the gestation and the animal is in advanced gestation, based on the individual need, particularly the diet will be increased up to 10 to 20% at regular intervals for the last trimester. And this should be done over a period of time because to limit the gastrointestinal stress. And during the prepartum, a total of 60% of diet can be increased over the maintenance diet. And during the late pregnancy, one should be very cautious that the female may not consume a large amount of fruit.
Yes, Vimal, I'm there. Yes, 1 minute. Yeah, I'm informing.
And these increases should also be taken, should also take place in 10 to 20% at regular intervals again. So anyone can please let me know where it got ended last time. Like so here I got this. Okay. Yeah. Before. Died during breeding season, right? So, sorry, because of few connection problems. Yeah, and died during breeding season. And as you know, diet plays a very important role in the healthy development of the fetus, as well as the health of the dam. So, in the first 2/3 of the gestation, that is up to 46th day. An increase of 10 to 20% of the feed, and we generally increase up to 20% of the feed as mandatory. And later on, at the late gestation, that is after the 47th day, based on the individual needs of the animal, there will be a 10 to 20% increase at regular intervals or the last trimester. This is done to limit the possibilities of gastrointestinal stress, where the animal may not be able to take the suddenly take the increased quantities of feed. And in the prepartum, a total of 60% increase over the maintenance is required. And during the late pregnancy, the animal may not be able to consume the increased amount of the feed because of the presence of the growing fetuses, which make it difficult to consume the large amount of feed at a time. So at that time, we generally practice giving smaller amounts of feed at more frequent intervals. And at our zoo, after the completion of the mating process, we generally follow that feed will be increased on a gradual manner, which reaches up to 50 to 60%. And they are supplemented with the calcium around 1%, which comes around 7 grams per kg of meat. And then multivitamins and trace minerals are regularly supplemented during the prepartum period. And additionally, mutton is provided as a complete limb as a source of calcium, and which also gives the animal in some activity like gnawing and chewing at the complete limb. And coming to postpartum care, during lactation, because of the high litter size, these dogs they generally require a very high amount of diet, which almost up to 3 times of the maintenance diet is required, which is at peak lactation, that is about 4 weeks from the postpartum. So these increases will be also take place in a gradual manner. That is also to limit the gastrointestinal stress. And coming to neonatal care, pups open their eyes generally at around 8 to 19 days, and they are given regurgitated food by the dam at around 31st day. So what we generally follow in the neonatal care is first and the most forward thing that dewormings and all the prophylactic measures. So deworming is done at the age of 40th day prior to vaccination. So at the time of deworming, only we take the sex determination of the animals, body weights, temperatures, measurements, and they are all regularly recorded. And after that vaccination, we give a combined booster vaccine of canine distemper, hepatitis, parvovirus, and para. At 21 days is interval, and this was followed by the annual boosters regularly. And vaccination against rabies is first in at the age of 90 days, because there will be maternal immunity. So at the first 90 days of age, after the 90 days of age, we give the rabies vaccine, and which is followed by 20 boosters on the 21 days, after 21 days, and annual boosters. So prophylactic measures, coming to prophylactic measures, which play a very important role in the maintaining health of the animals in the captivity. So various measures, like prophylactic measures, is a very broad term, where any measure that we are taking in order to prevent a disease that we can consider as a prophylactic. So what we generally practice is starting from the deworming, where we screen the fecal samples every month to detect any presence of endoparasites, and if any animal is found to be positive, and it will be dewormed accordingly. So we go for mass deworming for every 3 months, where we use a rotational use of broad spectrum deworming agents. So like at first we use a combination of the drugs, next we will go with the ivermectin after 3 months, then we will shift to the pantoprazole. So we use it on a rotational basis. So here we can see we use praziquantel, pyrantel pamoate, and pantoprazole combinations, and ivermectin plus praziquantel combinations. These are available commercially, and the doses are 1 tablet per 10 kg body weight. And other drugs, we also use ivermectin, which is very much efficient against nematodal infections, doramectin. So we use doramectin when any when there is a large amount of infections, any worm infections, and if the animal is anorectic, then we will go with the doramectin, where we can give doramectin intramuscularly, because ivermectins we can give either orally or subcutaneously. So we prefer doramectin at the time to give intramuscularly, and then we go with fenbendazole at the rate 50 mg per kg for 3 days, which we will give orally, and albendazole. This is also 25. We give at 25 to 50 mg per kg body weight for 3 days, but its use is contraindicated in the early pregnancy. So albendazole use is almost restricted during the breeding season. So here we have fecal analysis of our wild dogs in the last 1 year. So here we have divided our enclosures as A and B, as you can see, and breeding center. So fecal analysis is regularly carried out for every animal. Like, we take it as a pack. So if, for example, we are having some around 10 dogs in our A mode, so out of which if it
Is there a problem again?
Yes, no.
Please reach out to him. Is he getting connected, or is it going to take time?
He's getting connected. Mama.
If he's not there, we can start with the Purushottam biologist's presentation.
Okay. So at the end, we can have again Dr. Purushottam talk. So now we will continue with conservation biologist Purushottam. So Purushottam has completed his Master's of Science in Zoology and Bachelor's of Education. Currently, he is working in zoo for the last 3 years. He will speak us today on reproductive biology of Asiatic wild dog, breeding behavior followed by enrichment activities of Asiatic wild dog. Over to you, Purushottam.
Purushottam, you're not audible. It's something with wrong with your audio system, I believe. Do you have a headphone? Please connect that. I can't hear you.
If he's not there, we can start with Purushottam Pai.
No, not yet. Yes. Probably the sound had come earlier. Purushottam, try again.
Sorry, I think I lost my connection. So.
Yeah, Dr. Purushottam, since you are back, please start.
Yes, please. So sorry again. Anyone can please tell me where I lost. Am I audible?
Yes, for sure.
11th slide. Here? Oh,
yes, this was the slide, yeah.
Am I audible now?
Yes,
you're audible. For go ahead.
And as a measure of deworming and populate images, we regularly carry out a fecal analysis of our wild dogs, where you can see we have divided our three enclosures. A and B are the display space, and it is our breeding center. So we can see a case of Toxocara. So it is specifically Toxocara canis, which was treated with ivermectin orally. And then we have another B mode. It was positive for ankylostoma, which is a hookworm. It was treated with EZPET, which contains pyrantel, pamoid, fenbendazole, and rhizoctone. Where hookworms are susceptible for pyrantel, pamoid, and fenbendazole, we used it. And other measures like hookworms, where they cause the bleeding in the intestine, so we also supplement iron supplements during in those infections. And we regularly carry out sampling of the feces again to after the deworming to determine whether the infection is still the infection is there or not. And coming to vaccination, as we discussed earlier, it will first start at the age of 45 days, followed by the boosters at 21 days and yearly boosters. And what we generally use is live attenuated freeze-dried vaccines, which against canine distemper virus, canine adenovirus, type 1, type 2, and canine parvovirus, and canine parainfluenzavirus. And inactivated vaccines are used against Leptospira, Canicola, and enterohemorrhagia, and rabies. So disinfection schedule, we adopted various disinfection schedules which on daily schedules, monthly schedules, quarterly schedules, and yearly schedules, which plays a very prominent role in preventing the spread of the diseases and also their aquariums. So removal of the leftover feed in the enclosures is prime important because of which may attract flies, and so they are removed regularly, and regular disinfection of the enclosures with the chemical grade disinfectants like Nutralite with 1%, which is available commercially as a Corsolin, and addition of diethyl dimethyl ammonium chloride, which is being used as a water sanitizer, and that water is being supplied for all the purposes at the breeding centers and all our moats, and providing food tubes at the entry of the enclosures with the mono-persulfate compounds as a preventive measure, and cleaning of the feed and water troughs with 1% potassium permanganate and drying them in the sun. So these are all the measures which we generally practice on a daily basis. And monthly schedule is cleaning of the weeds and vegetation in and around the enclosures, and spraying of deltamethrin, which are available commercially as Budox at 2 ml per liter. And these dilutions are based on the recommendations of the manufacturer. And these are done as a measure of tick and flea control measures, because ticks and fleas, they cause a wide variety of diseases, hemoprotozoa diseases. So as a control measure, so we take these measures on monthly basis. And quarterly schedule, where all the moats and the enclosures are flame sterilized, and we generally practice scraping of the top soil substrate in all the enclosures on a quarterly basis, which helps in removing any fecal matter in the enclosures in the day crawls. And we regularly sample the water, all the water sources that are being supplied to the breeding centers and other moats for the quality analysis and microbiological examinations. And on a yearly schedule, we take up whitewashing of all the enclosures and painting all the enclosures with the lead-free paints, and changing of the sand or the turning of the soil after mixing with the lime, which really helps in preventing all the any presence of parasite load in the enclosures by desiccating if any eggs are present by desiccation. And coming to common diseases which you generally see are bacterial diseases or Leptospira, Clostridia perfringens, Salmonella species, and enteric E. coli infections. So apart from Leptospira, the remaining three we can say it as enteric bacterial diseases, where they primarily cause the gastrointestinal upsets. And for Leptospira, we are using vaccination. And for viral diseases, which are common diseases, canine distemper, parvovirus, ICH, and rabies, we are using vaccines against all these. And coming to protozoal infections, Giardia species, Balanitia coli, and Entamoeba histolytica, these are rare in occurrence, but they have the zoonotic risk. So tick-borne diseases, you can see babesiosis, hepatogenosis, ehrlichiosis, and anaplasmosis. So as we saw in the prophylactic measures, cleaning of the vegetation and application of the Budox, deltamethrin, and around the enclosures, which really helps in eradicating of these diseases. And we can see fly-borne diseases, trypanosomiasis and leishmaniasis. Trypanosomiasis were also reported in wild dogs at other zoos. So fly repellents are also regularly used. So what are the regular cases that we take at our zoo? Like traumatic injuries. So this one I presented because this is not a regular case, where it is happened in one of our display units, where two packs of animals, they are regularly placed in adjacent enclosures, cubicles. But what happened that day was there is a small gap between the two cubicles where our keeper he left a small opening which is not deliberate. So he was cleaning, and suddenly one dog from one pack immediately attacked the dog, which was very severe. And we can see here all the muscles and gastrocnemius muscles, they are completely severed. There is a loss of huge amount of blood, and we have taken radiographs to confirm any fractures, but we can see all the muscles were
We can probably start with Purushottam, biologist.
Purushottam, are you there? Okay. Purushottam.
Divya, I'm audible?
Yes, yes, Purushottam, you're audible.
Thank you.
All of you are on unmute, so that's why there is echo. Dr. Purushottam isn't online, right? Yeah. Purushottam, are you there?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Your voice is echoing, Purushottam. Present your slides and start your presentation.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm audible, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Can I start? Good afternoon, one and all. Myself, I'm Purushottam. I'm a conservation biologist, currently working in IGZP, Visakhapatnam. From the last few days, some senior scientists and wildlife experts briefly explained about these beautiful creatures. Now I would like to discuss about the reproductive biology, breeding behavior, and the enrichment activities of Asiatic wild dog in my field experience at IJZP. Now I'll share my screen with you all. Is it visible? Yeah, thank you. Okay, it's visible now. Okay. Okay. Asiatic wild dog is known, also known as the dhole, a red dog, or a whistling dog. Asiatic wild dog is one of the most fascinating predators of Indian jungles. Now, previously, we also discussed with Pallavi and Dr. Purushottam also explained brief about these wild dogs. Now, I'm telling about the reproductive biology, breeding behavior, and enrichment activities of Asiatic wild dog. Generally, those live in packs range from 5 to 15. As each pack containing a dominant pair of dholes, mostly this dominant pair of leads this group. Now coming to the reproductive biology. Reproductive biology of Asiatic lion. Wild dogs are monogamous in nature. It means a sexual relationship with only one partner at a time. And they are cooperative breeders with male-based adult sex ratio in packs. And The breeding season of Asiatic lion peaks in September to November. The female gave birth once a year and have a gestation period of about 60 to 17 days. Generally, the pups are born blind and the eyes open when they are in 2 weeks old. Initially, the pups had a shorty brown coat with a gradually changed to rusty red colored phase during the development. The pups suckle from the mother until they are about 3 weeks old. The pups are weaned by about 6 to 7 weeks, also in captivity. But in our observations, pups stopped suckling completely about 10 weeks of age. Next one. The breeding behavior of Asiatic wild ducks. Mostly we are seeing courtship Asiatic wild ducks. Courtship means it is the behavior of reproduction. Mostly the species select their partner for reproduction. Usually the male starts the courtship and the female choose their mate or reject the male based on this performance. And the wild ducks, the wild ducks courtship is categorized by frequent urine marking and vocalizing by the both sexes. This character we generally observe in our street dogs, our pet dogs also. It is continuously urinate and smell their anal region and genitalia region also. And by the female licking and molting of the male also. This type of interactions were observed in the month of October when the reproductive behavior were displayed by the dominant pair. Please see the picture number one, the alpha male sniffing the vagina of alpha male. The male does not quite often during the mating season to the test her reproductivity. And the second slide also, you observe the male also smell the female body posture, and this type of coat which were generally observed in wild ducks. Second one, mating process. This mating behavior observed in the peaks in October month and continuously done with the November. The mating process was observed generally the male lick the female and molting, capillary tight and the back-to-back copulatory posture. We are observed in pictures also, picture one, picture two, you have seen this type of mating were observed in wild ducks. And in my field observation captivity, we have recorded that the copulatory tie can at least between 7 to 14 minutes long period. And second one, pregnancy sign. After completed the successful mating, then how to identify the pregnancy male? It's very simple. The female seems normal first 2-3 weeks after the mating process. Before parturition, the female show pregnancy signs like showing dunning behavior. Most generally, the dunning behavior common in wild ducks for the resting purpose and breeding purpose also. This dunning behavior is generally observed in wild ducks in the wild and captivity also. Mostly, we are pregnancy signs observed in like abdomen development and tits enlargement, and most of the time the female stays den only. Some particular time it come out from the den and see the all surroundings and food and water purpose. It will come and go back to the dens. Its general observations we are noticed in the pre-parturition time. Before giving birth, the female seems very dull, inactive compared to other normal days. The female completely stay in the dens only. And dens. What is the role of dens in breeding of Asiatic ducks? Dens are the essential component of successful breeding and rearing of offspring. Mostly wild duck use this dens for breeding purpose. About 2 to 3 months, the mother doe rearing the cubs, particularly in this dense only. Sometimes it will come food and water purpose only. However, the denning and maternal care behavior is captive is not clearly understood to efficiently manage and breed of the endangered canid. We can mostly observe mostly in wild dogs stay with the dens with their cubs only. Parental care of Asiatic wild dog. The parental care of Asiatic wild dog, mostly the mother display extreme caution of while carrying the pups by holding them on the scruff of their neck. You see the first picture, the cub carry the pup and holding on the scruff of their neck with their mouth. And second picture, we clearly observed the feeding of pups of Asiatic lion near the den point. Mostly mother is the caretaker of this wild dog pups. She was very aggressive towards the animal keeper and any other anonymous person near the enclosure. At the initial stage of pup development, we always try to put them back inside the den. As the pups try to come out and explore their surroundings, we are observed in captivity. And another aspect we observed, some vocal communication and play behavior observed among the pups and the dam. The most interactions we observed in the particular time period of during the pups in dams, we particularly observed. She defended the pups very aggressively up to about 6 months of age. About 6 months of age, the mother caretaker of these pups, curling around pups, licking, grooming, suckling, and alarm calls. These all are the pup care behavioral activities. And another interesting fact about this caring pups is non-breeding subordinate and subdominant pack members also were observed spending the amount of time to caring of the pups. Next. Pup development. Generally, pups suckle from the mother until they are about 3 weeks old. Pups are weaned by the 6 to 7 weeks, although in captivity. We are recorded at IJZP 8 to 9 weeks. This is the weaning period of Asiatic wild dog pups. Pups were seen actively feeding beef made with the small pieces and mixed with the feed supplement about the 6 week of age. After a mother dole was given birth, the cub, some of the other adult members take part of feeding the mother, as also juvenile babies till they are around 3 weeks old and gradually learn to take solid feed. In captivity, we are clearly observed the developing skills from the pups. Pups were observed to pick up life skills during the play with parents and among themselves. Various behaviors, mocking, hunting, ambush, chase, escape, molting, etc. were observed. Pups should be retained with the parents from about 10 to 12 months, since the pups will cup up the several skills in the process. We have seen first slide, first picture in this slide, the feeding of mother, and the second one we observed. The second picture we have observed, the pups had a shoot brown coat, then gradually developed this pup and it's changed its color also with the red coated, and gradually they increase step by step in caretaker of mother. And And next one is enrichment activities. Enrichment activities are more important in captivity because this wild is a social animal. It's very stressful in captivity condition. We are providing a good enrichment for this purpose. It will be very active and it's very helpful to the breeding purpose also. In IJZP, we are providing some enrichment activities from the last few years. I will discuss some enrichment plannings of this in IJZP. Please see the first picture in this slide. One dog is playing with playing in water pool. Actually, wild dogs are water loving dogs and have been observed spending considerable amount of time playing in water. However, pups are prone into skin infection in the damp environment. So the provision of water pool may be abundant during the first day of development. See the second picture, we're providing a natural environment to the this enclosure. We're providing a vegetation of bamboo, thickets, grass, etc. This is the main useful for resting and feeding purpose also. There are a pack of wild dogs are sitting there and observe their surroundings. They feel very naturally. And see the third slide. We have hired some feed items in their enclosure. Actually, wild dogs have a good smelling sense. So that's why we have some hired some feed items in the enclosure. Immediately go there and smelling and digging. So there are some activities we are observed. And they are we providing some relief of this wild dogs also. And fourth picture, you observe some dog jump very high. Generally, wild dogs jump about 6-7 to 8 feet of the hay. That's why we are providing another enrichment also. What it is, generally, pack members actively participate in feeding because we're providing a goat legs hanger to the branch or pole with a rope. Feeding beef with the bone or goat legs, a good enrichment technique as would encourage the dog to work together. Hanging the food up tight to rope, the legs will be worked together to pull it. It's also strengthening the jaw muscle. It will observed in picture number 4. And I will show some... Now I will show some this related activities with video play. Is it visible video? Yes, we observed here one goat leg hanging in the branch of tree. We will actively participate in this enrichment in our IJZP enclosure. Yeah, finally it cast that leg. Yeah, another slide we observed one dog actively play in this pool. This kind of things we are observed in this enrichment. And again, I will show one breeding activity slide. Yeah. This is the breeding behavior of Asiatic wild dog at Indiraganj Zoological Park. We have making some video clippings to explore this session. I will play. Yeah, here we are showing some Dunning behavior of female duck. After birth and the blind pups were observed. Neonatal care of wild duck pups in their enclosure. This type of activities we have done in IJZP. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Ananda, for giving this wonderful opportunity to me.
Thank you, Purushottam, for the most informative and interesting talk. Now, can we go with Dr. Purushottam?
Yes, dear.
Yes, can is the signal support right there? Dr. Purushottam, are you there? Okay, now Pallavi, are you there? Pallavi?
Yes, yes, I'm here.
Yes, okay. Now we can conclude today's session and we can go up with the questions. So the first question is for the Pallavi. One of the viewers is asking, how do dolls communicate when predators attack?
When predators attack them, like the tiger attacks them, is that? Yeah, so normally tigers don't attack them as such, but if they happen to come in close quarters, then the reaction of dolls is to obviously run away. But they have these very interesting loud calls like cackles, which they do to scare away the tigers. And all of them doing that together in a pack is actually quite scary to just shoo away the tiger.
Okay, thank you. The second question is, what all the development projects can be taken to protect these endangered species as they are loss of habitat and ecosystem disturbance?
What are the, I didn't get you.
Okay, I'll repeat it. What are the development projects can be taken in further for these endangered species as they are due to loss of habitat and disturbance and due to ecosystem disturbance?
If I get it clearly, they are asking about the developmental projects, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so developmental projects like highways and linear infrastructure that is coming up nowadays have wonderful overpasses through these forested areas, which the dolls have been using for, you know, moving along the forest paths. So there are these developmental projects that come up, and we can have mitigation measures like these overpasses from where, you can mitigate the fragmentation effects that happen.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Pallavi, for answering the questions. Now we'll move up on with Dr. Purushottam. Are you there?
Yes,
okay. The first question is, during this pandemic, we have seen some of the endangered species are also being affected with COVID-19. So what are the preventive measures to be taken, especially focusing on Asiatic wild dogs?
Okay, so COVID-19, which is taking a toll on many of the zoos by affecting mostly feral species. So as far as now, we have no reports on canids which are housed at various zoos that are infected with COVID-19. But we do have infections of COVID-19 with the big cats. So as many researchers said that the most susceptible species for the COVID-19 at the captive management or being in the wild, they are felids and primates, Mustelidae and Viverridae. So coronavirus, which infects dogs, is completely different from the COVID-19, where canine coronavirus, it belongs to alpha coronavirus, whereas present occurring COVID-19, it belongs to the beta coronavirus. So I think in captive populations or in the wild, Asiatic wild dogs, COVID-19 may not be affected and we didn't have any occurrences still. So by following all the prophylactic measures like care of the keepers that are attending to the housed animals in the zoos, so that's the prime importance we have to focus on.
Okay. The second question is, due to COVID-19, is there any change in diet schedule?
No. Actually, we didn't make any changes in the diet schedule, but we implemented methods like the feed which is being given to the animals, they are dipped in the hot water for around 10 minutes, and then they are dipped in the 1% potassium permanganate solutions also. So apart from that, there are no changes in the diet schedule of them, especially wild dogs.
Okay, thank you. Now we'll move up on with Purushottam, conservation biologist. Purushottam, are you there?
I am.
So the first question is, the litter size of wild dog is about 3 to 7. Sometimes it increases its numbers to 8 to 18. Then how to manage the feeding and caring?
Yeah. Generally, female wild dogs has a large number of teats and able to give birth a large number of babies. And another thing, all member of the group X take care of mother and her babies also. She can easily manage their breeding and caring aspects.
Okay. The second question is, what are the adaptations to dolls have?
Actually, wild dogs are very fascinating hunters in Indian jungles. They have very skillful. They have very skillful creatures. Each wild dog, it can jump 7 to 8 feet on air, and it's hunt together with pack. All packs are hunt together, and they live with leopards, tigers, and other enemy predators. The dole also a strong swimmers and usually forced to prey into the water before it attacks. They will eat very survival in captivity and as wild.
Okay, thank you, Purushottam. Thank you all speakers who have joined here. So with this, we conclude today's session. Thank you all for joining. We especially thank Central Zoo Authority for taking such a unique initiative for conservation to coexistence, the People's Connect outreach activities as part of Bharat Ka Amrit Mahotsav, celebration of 75 years of India's independence. I also take this opportunity on behalf of Andhra Pradesh Forest Department to thank speakers of today's session and all the participants. I also thank our curator, Dr. Nandini Salaria, for the massive support towards the programs held throughout the week. I also thank all other officers and everyone who are all involved in this program during along this week. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Have a nice day. Thank you.